service of ordination. This is a service of the presbytery of hope. Evangelical covenant order of presbytery. Since we are, this is actually a service of the presbytery, and it is a joint filled service. We are, we have the privilege, the sacred privilege of being part of the ordination of John Keats. So we know that you know John, and so we're glad that you're here. We're celebrating today what God has done, what God has been planning to bring John to this place for such a time as this. And we know that good ministry is going to continue through John and his Lord's Spirit. I can say just a couple of announcements I want to know about. Following the service, there's going to be a reception outside, so it'll be that could be really cool, by the way, right? We'll turn on the air conditioner out there, so just outside we're going to have a wonderful reception. Later in the service, we're going to take an offering, and that offering will be used for church planting in our presbytery. So it's a very wonderful opportunity for you to give and be participate in the ministry that we are doing. Let's prepare our hearts to worship together.
Let's go.
Jesus said it. Will you pray with me? Holy God, you give the church varied gifts and ministries and call men and women to receive and fulfill them. Open us now to the power of your Holy Spirit as we gather to offer you our thankful praise, worship, and continued dedication in our ministry to the church and the world. Let us know the joy of your presence and the calling we have been given to be your people in the name of Jesus. Be present with us, Lord, we pray, as we ordain John Titus to your service, and help us to continue to lift him up in prayer and support throughout his coming ministry. All these things we ask in the name of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ.
Please confess your sins to the Lord first in time of quiet meditation and personal prayer. Let us confess our sins to the Lord together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, and what our hearts can no longer bear. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open us to a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image, through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. I'm going to go to the hospital.
said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. Said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him a third time, do you love me? He said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wish. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone will fasten a belt around you and take you where you don't want to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which you would glorify God. After this, he said to him, follow me. This is the word of the Lord. Let's speak to you. I'd like to say that believe that that was the first ordination service on the beach. So later in this service, we will be asking you a follow-up question. What's the church love questions? They'll be about your calling to this ministry. And then we will charge you with caring for God's people. Feeding sheep, feeding lambs, shepherding sheep. This is no small task. It's a high calling. It's good work. Lord, these words are your words. They're eternal. They do not change. Thus, it is you who should speak them. So we ask that the Holy Spirit, your Spirit, will be our guide and our teacher in these words. Last week, I had the privilege of going with a group of people from Mountain View to see the Holy Land, which seems pretty amazing given what's going on there now. Returning home on Sunday and knowing, meeting so many people, knowing where we were, and watching here in the news right now is hard to fathom. We went to many sites, and one of the sites we went to was a place on the Sea of Galilee, which some of you who've been there maybe have seen this. It's a rocky shore at the beach, and it's very, very peaceful and calm. And it very well may have been the very place where Jesus cooked breakfast, served bread and fish to his disciples. If it wasn't there, it was probably, most certainly, very, very close. And so we stood there, and we had a feel and a sense of where this wonderful scene took place. It was so peaceful. 2,000 years ago, the resurrected Jesus met with his fishermen disciples there on that beach, and he had these intimate moments with Peter. And remember, not long ago, Peter had denied him three times. There on that beach, Peter encountered intimate love and care, full of grace and full of truth, coming from Jesus. And Jesus gave Peter a charge that really focuses on two things that I want to echo here and work for you John today. Two words, feed and follow. Jesus said to Peter, feed my sheep. Now, certainly this has to do and been all about caring for physical needs. Feed my sheep. There were many in that world who were hungry, as there are in our own world and in our own community. Jesus gives hungry fishermen bread and fish. Now, I love this scene. You can put all of our imagination to employ it for the smells. I mean, you can smell the raw fish on the grill and the fire. You can hear the birds in the air and the small waves of the Sea of Galilee crashing on the shore. And there's a calm and a peace. And the resurrected Jesus is there. Jesus says to Peter, I want you to feed my sheep. Each follower of Jesus is called to give food and care for those who are hungry. The widow, the poor, the orphan, the refugee. To be a follower of Jesus is to feed those who are hungry, to care for physical needs. And certainly all of us who are pastors this summer here this afternoon, we are to be engaged in that kind of work and that kind of ministry. It's good ministry. It's caring there is more here, and that is at the point, God, we're ordaining you to today. We need you to feed us, all of us, with God's word and with God's sacrament. Our hearts are hungry. Our souls are not parched. And we want you to do this. Feed us. We are ordaining you to be immersed in the words of our Lord. Be immersed in the words of Scripture. Let the words of Jesus roll off your tongue. Tell us the biblical stories over and over and over again. Tell us the stories of Pharaoh and Peter, of Amos and Andrew, of Jonah and James, of Samuel and Stephen. Never grow tired of telling us and sharing with us and being excited about the great biblical story. The Greek mythology, Odysseus was worried about succumbing to the siren voices of in his shipmates travel, and so he was tied up. He was lashed to the mast of the ship, unable to steer or change direction. God, we're watching you in this ordination into a world filled with siren voices, tempting voices, trying to get all of our attention. Voices filled with promise, of power, and glamour, and success, half-truths, false things. But today, because we believe that we need you to hold fast to the truth of the gospel in order that you may minister to us. Now, this is going to happen in many contexts. The fishermen were at work when they met Jesus that day. You will no doubt meet others on fishing expeditions, but you will also meet them at school cafeterias, corporate offices, academia boardrooms, grocery store parking lots. But the word of Christ will often dwell in you richly in all those places. In all of these places, the words of Jesus need to be announced and celebrated full of joy. Create scenes like that breakfast on the beach, intimate moments where Jesus' words are present. Also need you to pay particular attention to the end of the story. We need you as pastor to have in mind at all times how this God story ends, where it's going. When Julie and I moved to the East Coast Early Seminary in New Jersey, we were young and newly married, and we had a free evening, and we were so excited about this. We were able to go on Broadway in New York City to see the play Les Mis. This is something we dreamed about. On Broadway, full Broadway, we get to go see Les Mis. I had never seen Les Mis before. I didn't really know the story. We never been to a Broadway play before. It's a big thing for me. So I decided I would call my sister, who she had lived in New York City. She's kind of a veteran of all things theater. And I said, "Amy, what do I need to know? And give me some tips. Give me some. We're going to this. This is kind of a big night for us. What do I need to know?" She said, "This is what I want you to do. When you get there, they're going to give you this thing called a play bill. And in it, it'll have the entire storyline of the play. It'll tell you, I want you to get there early, read the entire story. I want you to know what's happening and where it's going and how it ends." Now, I thought this was crazy. Why would I do that? I want some suspense. Like, why would I learn about what's going to happen in this play before I even protest and say, "Come on, this is my first time. I want to just trust me. I want you to get to know how this is going to go and how it's going to end. I want you to know all of that. Because in this play, I want you and I need you to enjoy the music. And I don't want you worried about what's coming next or what may or may not happen. This is a different genre. We live in a world, in our community, where kingdom music is being played on the radio. It's problem is so many of us are missing this because we're worried about what's coming. We're so worried about what's going to happen next. Or what am I going to lose? We get so caught up in the storyline. And injustice. We need you to point to the end of the story where there is justice for the nation. In your ministry, when you encounter false worship and idolatry, you can point to the end of the story where we find the great multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and every knee bowing to Jesus. If you have sorrow and grief in your ministry, you won't be immersed in the knowledge that the end of the story. Taste and see that the Lord is good. We need to feel this word, the sacraments. Augustine said that the sacraments are signs pertaining to the divine, are visible forms of an invisible grace. And so we pray that your ministry will be marked by every day by an opportunity to make visible the inward reality of grace. With the water of baptism, with the bread and the wine, the sacrament. This we enter into the large and wonderful and mysterious place where God's grace is made manifest. Where we confess that we are not keepers of our future, but Christ is the one who holds us and lives in His name. A guy named Max Dupree, he told the story that he said that Esther, my wife, and I have a granddaughter named Zoe. And that's the Greek word for life. He said she was born prematurely and she weighed 1 pound, 7 ounces. Can you imagine? Straight up, 1 pound, 7 ounces. So small, he said that my wedding ring could slide up her arm all the way up to her shoulder. The nurse who first examined her told us that she had a 5 to 10% chance of living 3 days. And when Esther and I scrubbed up for our first visit and saw Zoe in her isolate and the neonatal intensive care unit, she had 2 IVs that were enabled, one on her foot, monitor on each side of her chest, and a respirator tube, a feeding tube in the mouth. And he writes this, he says, to complicate matters, Zoe's biological father had jumped ship to once before she was born. Realizing this, a wise and caring nurse gave me my instructions. For the next several months at least, you are going to be the surrogate father. I want you to come to the hospital every day to visit Zoe, and when you come, I want you to rub her body with the tip of your finger. And while you are caressing her, you should tell her over and over again how much you love her, because she has to be able to connect your voice to your tongue. What a privilege it is to announce, to share the word of the Lord, and to say your taste. Verse 19. After this, Jesus said to Peter, "Follow me." You know, sometimes we forget that it was a small band of followers of Jesus who turned the known living world in their day right side up. The church today does not need more leaders. We need followers who are accessible. Leadership rises from the ranks of those who have never followed and never forgive to keep following Jesus. There are thousands of books Everyone has a theory, everyone who has succeeded in some profession, which usually means becoming famous or making a pile of money, feels the need to write about the answer. The most dream is about pain. How to get it. Sadly, in the church, we get just as upset as this. I get 5 to 6 invitations into my email or my mailbox every week to attend a leadership conference. And it's amazing how many experts there are in terms of leadership. I could spend all my time going to leadership conferences and never actually leading them. And yet, it's interesting, isn't it, that with all this attention, the church is dying for good things. In the church, the evaluation of leadership often comes down to numbers, how many are in the congregation, how big of a building, how large the budget, the bigger the numbers, the more successful the leader is. John, you have so many good and wonderful leadership gifts, and they're going to be used. God's going to use them to be as exemplary for His kingdom. But what we really need are your followers. Jesus credit, watch feet, sit in the back. We need you to be a gifted follower. Let Jesus lead, let Him get all the glory, allow Him to shine. Like John the Baptist, let all of us pastors say, He must increase while I must decrease. So let it, this afternoon, when a word of charge is very simple, would you follow Jesus? Would you do that? Will you walk with Him? We don't need any more larger than life pastors. We don't need any more TV shows and leadership seminars. We have plenty of pastors clamoring to play the lead in the orchestra, but few willing to play second fiddle. But we're dying for someone to show us what it's like to walk with Jesus and to follow Him. Now, sometimes walking with Jesus will always make sense to you. Sometimes it will feel like you're walking alone. Sometimes the events of the day or the pain in your life or in others' lives will make walking with Jesus costly and painful. In those times, will you please keep walking with Jesus? It's what the church needs. It's what we need. Will you do it? Lastly, when I was ordained, Kelly, one more thing. We're going to redeem you to this ministry, and then you want your vow that you're going to stick to it. This is not a temporary job assignment, but a way of life that we need lived out in our community. We know that you are launched on the same difficult belief venture in the same dangerous world as we are. We know your emotions are as fickle as ours, and your mind is as tricky as ours. That's why we're going to ordain you, and why we're going to exact a vow from you. We know there will be days and months, maybe even years, when you won't feel like believing anything and you won't want to hear it. We won't want to hear it. And we know there will be days and weeks and maybe even years when you won't feel like saying it. No matter. Do it. You are ordained to this ministry, you're not to. There may be times when we come to you as a committee or a delegation and demand that you tell us something else. But what we are telling you, give in to what we demand of you. You are not the minister of our changing desires, or our time-conditioned understanding of our needs, or our secularized hopes for something better. With these vows of ordination, we are lashing you fast to the mass, the word, and sacrament, so you will be unable to respond to some of those. There are many other things to be done in this wrecked world, and we're going to do some of them. But if we don't know the foundational realities with which we are dealing, God, kingdom, gospel, we're going to end up living futile fantasy lives. Your task is to keep telling the basic story, representing the presence of the Spirit, insisting on the priority of God, speaking the biblical words of command and promise and invitation. That, or something very much like that, is what I understand the church to say there. What does it have right there? It's my little bread. And so for your charge, as a newly ordained pastor, I'm going to give you a tongue twister and a text. The tongue twister is a Christer's plus. Don't try saying that two times. See, you did better than I thought, so that's good. And the text is from the end of Joshua chapter 5. This is right before our review. Fights the battle of Jericho, giving us that wonderful African American spirit. Joshua was near Jericho. He looked up and saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and asked, "Are you for us or for our enemies?" "Neither," he replied. "But as the commander of the army of the Lord, I have no time." Then Joshua fell face down on the ground in reverence and asked him, "What message does my Lord have for us?" The commander of the Lord's army replied, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy." And Joshua did so. I want you to notice that what's happened in the life of Joshua is that he's becoming God's leader, as you are becoming God's leader. A pastor's posture involves four things: the call to notice, the nuance, the call to obedience, and the call to obedience. First is the call to notice. Joshua is just doing his rounds as the leader of God's people. And he notices a man with a drawn sword, and he knows, "I got to check this out." He notices. Now, John, you are already adroit at noticing business opportunities. Now you must become adroit at noticing God opportunities. What is God doing around you already? And how can you join? To lead God's people, you must respond to the call to God. Second, the call to nuance. Joshua thinks it's A or B. It can only be A or B. You're for us or you're for our enemies. And the leader of God's army gives him a third. Again and again, there'll be a situation where people want to do A or B, and God is calling you to do something different. It takes nuance to communicate that to God. You must respond to that call of God from your heart. And then there's the call to obedience, because immediately Joshua assesses the situation and says, "Aha! God is telling you something right now. God, what do you want me to do?" And there are all sorts of people that are telling you what to do all the time. Now that you are ordained, ego pastor, there'll be